in seats. Second night of the St. Bernard Chamber's Political Forums. My name is Jacques Alfonso, and I currently serve as the co-chair of the St. Bernard Parish Chamber of Commerce Political Forums Committee, along with Lisa Bowen. I'd like to thank all of you for coming out tonight to learn more about the candidates seeking office. Before we begin, I'd like to thank Roxanne Adams of St. Bernard Parish Government Clerk of Council, Rachel Segura, and Leo Murphy, of the Parish Government Film Department and Television, and Randy Russo from WDSU for their assistance again this evening, making this event a success. I'd also like to recognize the St. Bernard Chamber's 2023 annual sponsors. Without their support, events like this would not be possible. At the Parish Pillar level, we have Shelmet Refining, the Port of New Orleans, the St. Bernard Economic Development Foundation, St. Bernard Parish Government, and Valero. At the Commerce Partner level, we have Associated Terminals and the Ranch, and at the Business Advocate level, we have Clements Insurance Services, Complete Logistical Services, Gulf Coast Bank and Trust, and Silver Slipper Casino. Along with Atmos Energy, EMR Metal Recycling, Frederick J. Segura Investment Company, Hancock Whitney, Ordez Electric, Rain CII, Richie Lewis Council at Large West, and SSE Steel Fabrication. Thank you for your continued investment in the Chamber. I'd now like to introduce David Clements Sr., the 2023 Chairman of the St. Bernard Chamber of Commerce.
Thank you, Jacques. Before we begin, I would like to review the rules for this evening. I would like to also remind you all that early voting will begin September 30th through October 7th. The primary election will take place on October 14th. To view the ballots or find polling locations, please visit www.sos.la.gov. Also, this is a reminder that the St. Bernard Chamber of Commerce does not endorse any candidate for elected office. The purpose of this forum is strictly educational. We believe it is important for the business community and for the public to have the opportunity to hear from and learn more about each candidate's running for elected office. The questions used tonight were prepared by a committee of the St. Bernard Chamber of Commerce. We would like to thank the committee co-chairs, Jacques Alfonso and Lisa Bourne-Cott, along with the committee members for their hard work in preparing for tonight. Please note that no candidate or chamber staff has had the opportunity to review these questions ahead of time. During the forum, the candidates may request a question to be repeated. Candidates may not, however, request for further elaboration or interpretation of the question. Candidates should do their best to answer the questions as presented by the moderator. Questions will not be taken from the audience. Candidates will be mindful of the timekeepers and will end properly when his or her time to speak has ended. Candidates will be respectful of their opponents and refrain from any interruptions. Additionally, the audience will be respectful of all candidates and will refrain from any form of interruption. At this time, please ensure your phone is on silent. I'd now like to introduce our moderator, Randy Russo. For those that could not be with us last night, a little bit about Randy is that she is the morning anchor for the WDSU News This Morning, and for 17 years has worked to tell stories showcasing the resiliency of the people of Louisiana. She's been in broadcast journalism since 2007 and has worked her way up to become an anchor where she now finds her home at The Morning Show. As an award-winning journalist, Randy reports on a range of topics from festivals to storm recovery, education, and breaking news. Her proudest job is mom to Jacques, Stella, and her puppy, Huey P. Long, who all share her zest for life and love of Louisiana. Please join me in welcoming our moderator, my beautiful cousin, Randy Russo.
Thank you and good evening, everybody. I'm really excited to jump back into things again tonight and hear from even more candidates, this time running for state senator, parish president, council at large, east and west, council district E, and then closing it out with council district E. So we've got a full schedule ahead of this. D&E, yes. We have a full schedule ahead of us, so we're going to get things going. But at this time, I would like the candidates running for state senator to take the stage first. All the other candidates running for parish president, council at large, east and west, districts D and E, you can join a member of the chamber council behind the stage, the chamber, the council chamber behind the stage. You'll then be instructed on when it's your time to come forward. So at this time, those candidates running for state senator, Ray? Anyway, there's on a piece of paper, is where you can see, yeah. So the candidates for state senator, Ray Garofalo and Bob Owen. And each of you will give a 60-second opening statement to us. I'm going to give you a round of questions. Then you'll get a 60-second closing statement. I'm going to ask you three questions apiece. Now, if you want me to repeat it for you, I certainly can. But I cannot elaborate on the question or interpret it for you. And we're going to start off our forum now with your opening statement. Each of you, again, have 1 minute. And we'll begin with Mr. Ray Garofalo with his opening statement.
Thank you, Randy. You guys know me. I was born in Araby, raised here. I'm a grandfather, I have three grandchildren. I'm a dad, I have three children. My wife Joan and I, who's here in the audience tonight, and I raised our children together in Miro, and I'm getting a ringing and it's driving me crazy. I've been in the legislature for 12 years. I've had the honor of representing you guys for 12 years. I'm an attorney, I've been an attorney for 30 years. And I've owned, operated, started, and continue to operate several successful businesses. On every metric, I am the best candidate for state senate. I highly encourage you to go to my website, voteray.com, www.voteray.com, real easy to remember, research my background, my biography, and my accomplishments, and make an informed decision when you vote for your next senator. I humbly ask that you do that. Again, www.voteray.com. If you have any questions, please reach out to me. All of my contact information is right there.
Thank you, Mr. Garofalo. Mr. Bob Owen.
Thank you, Randy. So I'd like to introduce myself to a lot of you here tonight. I'm State Representative Bob Owen from Slidell. My district basically is Slidell from the lake all the way to the border. However, you know, and I grew up in Slidell. However, I did grow up also fishing in Delcro and hunting in Reggio. So I know this area very well, and I'm proud to have it in my district, my future district, hopefully. I'm a founding member of the Conservative Caucus. I've been on the Health and Welfare Committee, Transportation, the Drug Task Force, and the Drone Committee. Louisiana, going forward, we have a ton of potential here. We have all these wonderful things. We have the third largest river system in the world running through our state. We have great people, we have great food, we have great culture, but we have a problem with education, we have a problem with crime, we have problems with our infrastructure, DOTD, and we have a horrible problem with taxes and insurance. I believe that a constitutional convention is required in order to change a lot of the things that are wrong with this state, and I hope to be a part of that, and I hope to have your vote in the future. Thank you so much.
Mr. Owen, thank you. We'll now have our first question, and again, you'll have 90 seconds to answer each one of these questions. So for question one, what initiatives will you push for in the state senate to allocate funding for upgrading our roads, bridges, and other essential public facilities? And we'll begin with Mr. Owen.
So first thing I believe that needs to be done, frankly, is to, we almost need to eliminate the Department of DOTD and start from scratch. I talked to Governor DeSantis about that particular process, and that is what they pretty much did in Florida to fix their infrastructure system with the Department of Transportation. Outside of that, we're constantly fighting for tax dollars, for federal money, for state money to get DOTD to work. Anybody who's ridden by a construction project and sees people just standing around on the side of the road, or not, or construction that's taken months and months to you know, get completed, knows that there's a serious problem with the way that we do business in terms of funding our roads and funding our bridges, funding things like bridges, and then funding the rest of our general infrastructure. It has to change, and it's going to start with whoever the governor is, and hopefully we can work with the legislature to make that happen. So we're gonna work real hard to really turn DOTD into something we can be proud of, and something that can be effective for the state going forward.
Mr. Owen, thank you. Mr. Garofalo.
We've been working in the House. Let me give you a little background. In Louisiana, the governor has an inordinate amount of power. The governor is the one that sets the executive budget. He sends it over to the House. The House massages it, sends it to the Senate. And it's not just the executive budget. He also controls basically everything that goes on in capital outlay. Capital outlay is pretty much where we control everything that we spend on extra projects. We have the bridge program, we have the road program, and DOTD is supposed to take those projects in order of priority and need, and like the infrastructure that we're trying to get in St. Bernard Parish right now. We do see a lot of problems with the priority system based on politics. The group that I've been working with in the House for years has been trying to devise a plan, and we believe we have a plan that will take the control of the governor out of that process. He'll have input. The governor has to have input. But we need a more subjective way of deciding where the projects are going to go and how we're going to divvy up the money. DOTD is also very, very top-heavy. We have a lot of administrators in DOTD. A lot of the money that they spend is being spent on administration instead of going into our roads, bridges, and infrastructure. So we have to change that, and that's one of the things we've been working on as well. But if we can change the power structure so that it's a more subjective selection process, we'll have a lot better chance of more fairly fixing the infrastructure that we have in the state of Louisiana.
Okay, Mr. Garofalo, thank you. Question two, there is an insurance crisis right now in South Louisiana. What policies and or legislation will you support to make sure people aren't priced out of their communities because of the cost of homeowners and flood insurance premiums? And we'll begin with Mr. Garofalo.
Thanks again, Randy. Just this session, I had bills that strengthened the Fraud Protection Authority, fortified, if you have a fortified roof, it would force the insurance companies to tell you the amount of the discount that you'd receive for fortifying your roof or fortifying your home. It opened the whole fortified program up to multifamily dwellings, not just single family dwellings. I had a bill to create catastrophe savings accounts, similar to a health savings account, so that you could bank some money, so that when you have a catastrophe, you have some money in the bank. It would all be pre-tax. I don't have time to get into the details. But it would be an incentive for people to save for a rainy day so that they could use that for either their portion, which is the deductible portion of their claim, or to fix their home or their business. I had a bill to remove the 10% over the market requirement for Louisiana citizens. I had a bill to put railings on the appraisal process. If you haven't been thrown into the appraisal process, you have a real surprise coming. But that's something that has to be addressed. As an attorney, I understand what has to be done. And we changed a lot of the definitions. We had bills to change a lot of the definitions with what's going on in the insurance industry. You know, with what we see going on in the reinsurance market, the fortified program is the best way to start to reduce our insurance rates. We have to stabilize the market. All of the rates are based on how much the insurance companies have to pay out. Alabama has been very successful in reducing their rates and implementing the fortified program.
Mr. Garofalo, thank you. Mr. Owen.
Yes, so insurance is a very complicated issue. It's one that has many facets. We have tried to do some things with tort reform over the last couple of years. They have not been extremely successful, frankly. And you know, there's some things that you know we have done though, including the fortified roof program, which hasn't started, which will in fact bring rates down, and we've kind of guaranteed that in the law. One of the things though that we have to do in Louisiana, and it's gonna take a little bit of feather ruffling to get this done, but you know we're gonna have to open up the insurance market. And what that is going to entail is, you know, we have a ton of consumer protections, you know, in Louisiana that we have over insurance companies, you know, for the individual. And look, honestly, those are, you know, they're nice to have. The problem is, you know, it keeps other businesses out of the state. People don't want to deal with Louisiana. So it's one of those things that we just are going to have to kind of, you know, take a bite out of and you know, and you know, hopefully it's not, you know, something too bad. But we really need to get that insurance market open and more of a free market type of system. Also, the reinsurance aspect of insurance in the state. So, you know, reinsurance is the insurance that insurance companies use to basically insure themselves in case of, you know, three or four storms that come through. We kind of let that lapse a little bit, and then we had three or four storms come through in a single year. So that's one of the reasons our rates are so high.
Mr. Allen, thank you.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Question number three. Education is a priority for our community. What policies will you advocate for at the state level to improve funding for our local schools and ensure that our students have access to high-quality education? And we'll begin with Mr. Owen.
So education is a big thing that I, you know, it's one of the things I mentioned in my opening remarks. It's probably, in my terms, one of the most single important things that we can do to the state to improve it. There's a couple different things with education, though. You know, we have early childhood education, which needs to be funded, and that's been shown to be effective long-term. We've just passed a bill recently that doesn't allow children who cannot read by the third grade. They basically they're held back at that point, or they are given some kind of counseling or services to help them get up to you know, literacy rates. You know, the thing with that bill is, you know, up until third grade, you're learning how to read. After third grade, you're reading to learn. You know, so if you can't read by third grade, you know, it's a major issue. So we did pass that, and we have some other bills that are similar to that going through that hopefully will be passed in the next session. Another big thing with education, though, that people often forget to mention is you know, your higher education or older jobs. So you know, there's 140,000 unfilled jobs in Louisiana, and it's not because, you know, people don't want to work at these jobs. It's, well, there's probably a few that don't, but most of these people want to get these jobs filled. The issue is they don't have the proper certifications, and we have to get these people certified. We have to get them into education programs that are for older adults, vocational systems, you know, or either that or, you know, industry specific type of education that can get these people employed.
Mr. Owen, thank you. Mr. Carafalo.
Every year we hear the same thing. We're not funding education enough. We work really hard to do that. As a chairman of the Education Committee in the House, I work really hard to improve teacher salaries. I think we have to do that. We have an exodus. Teachers are leaving the state of Louisiana in droves right now. We have to do everything we can to bring our teacher salaries up to at least the Southern States regional average so that we have a chance of maintaining those teachers. We have to continue to make sure that we're supporting those teachers in the classroom. My daughter is a teacher. My wife's a former special ed teacher, and I hear it all the time, that we don't treat our teachers like professionals. I think that that's the key. You know, we have discipline problems in our classrooms. We passed the child protection bill last year. I worked with the author and helped her get that bill through. Not the child protection, I'm sorry, we have those as well. The Teacher Protection Act last year. And what that says is essentially that we're going to give our teachers some limited liability should they try to stop a fight in school. If somebody gets hurt, if they get hurt, we're going to protect them and stop them from being sued so that they won't lose their house just because they're trying to discipline a student. And again, in my humble opinion, I think we really have to do something about the discipline in the classrooms in order to bring up the standards of our students. We're 49th in the country almost every year. St. Bernard has been blessed that we have a good school system, but when the state is 48th or 49th in the country, what's it say about our system? We have to improve our teachers and improve our classrooms.
Mr. Garofalo, thank you. You'll now have 1 minute for your closing statements, and we'll begin with Mr. Garofalo.
But for the past 12 years, I've fought to promote our existing businesses and to do everything that we can to attract new business into the state of Louisiana. Some of the things that I've been fighting for on crime, I fought to deter crime and to protect our businesses and the customers that go to those businesses so that they feel safe. For education, we fought to improve our workforce development and to increase student standards. For insurance, and that's most recently, we fought really hard to try to stabilize the marketplace and to lower insurance rates, not just for businesses, but for individuals as well. The competition that we're facing on the state level is fierce. We don't have time for nice guys and good old boys in the state legislature anymore. We need fighters. We need warriors who aren't going to be afraid to do the work and make the tough decisions to keep Louisiana strong. As one of those warriors, I pledge to you that I will do everything I can to make Louisiana the best place to raise a family, and I humbly ask for your vote for Louisiana Senate, and may God bless every one of you, the great state of Louisiana, and the United States of America.
Mr. Garofalo, thank you. Mr. Owen.
Thank you very much. So, you know, I just want to start by saying, you know, when you're in this position, I've been a state rep for the past 4 years now, and you learn very quickly that you have to work with other people. I'm a very staunch Republican. However, I work with Democrats, independents, whoever I have to get things done for the people of my district. And that's what I'm going to do for everybody here who's in St. Bernard. We, you know, there are so many things that, you know, are wrong with Louisiana, but they can be fixed. We talked about, you know, education. You know, we need to stop shackling law enforcement and start shackling more criminals. We, you know, infrastructure, the taxes, insurance issues, and a constitutional convention are really required. I am the person who is going to be there for you. You know, although I grew up across the Lake Pontchartrain, you know, I still, you know, love this area. We grew up here hunting and fishing. I know the people here, and I want to do what's best for the people of St. Bernard. God bless Louisiana. God bless St. Bernard. Thank you.
Mr. Owen, thank you. And thank you again to our candidates running for state senator. Running for St. Bernard Parish President. And again, just a reminder, make sure your phones are off, and if you need to have a conversation, just exit the doors to have that conversation. So we are now going to introduce our St. Bernard Parish President candidates in alphabetical order. Carrie Calais, Wayne Landry, Emil Pelletieri, Louis Pomez. And as y'all are having a seat, I'm going to just remind you all that we'll have a 60-second opening statement for each of you to provide to the audience. After our round of questioning, you'll also get a 60-second closing statement. Each of you will be asked a total of 3 questions, and you'll be given 90 seconds to respond to each. If you need me to repeat a question for you, I'm certainly happy to do so. I just can't elaborate or interpret that question. But we're going to start off our forum with our opening statements. And again, each of you have 1 minute. We got Fred Eugene over here, so pay attention. They're our great little timekeepers. And we're going to start it off with Ms. Carrie Calais with 60 seconds.
Thank you, and thank you for the chamber for hosting us tonight. My name is Carrie Calais, and I'm running to be St. Bernard's next parish president. I believe that I'm the best choice for this position because of my qualifications, my involvement, my experience, and my relationships. I believe that I'm the only candidate that can say that they have all 4 of those qualities. I'm a lifelong resident of St. Bernard. I went to high school at Archbishop Hannon, graduated with honors, and then got my bachelor's degree in political science from SLU. For the last 20 years, I have been a managing partner of a multi-million-dollar business, and I own my own real estate investment company. I've been involved in the civic community long before I was elected to office. I've been chairwoman of the St. Bernard Chamber of Commerce. I co-founded Leadership St. Bernard. I have been secretary treasurer of the Save Louisiana Coalition and a board member of the Nunez Community College Foundation. For the last 8 years, I have served as your council at large East, and I've been proud to be a part of the progress that we've seen in St. Bernard. I'm running to be your next parish president because I want to keep us moving forward on that path.
Ms. Thank
Kelly,
you. Thank you. Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Wayne Landry.
Thank you. I'm Wayne Landry. I bring to this campaign a degree in public administration and a wealth of experience in navigating through the intricacies of government bureaucracies. I have 38 years of experience as a CEO and basically working with government entities. This experience is all in the upper level of administration. Our parish deserves a leader who understands the complexities of our administrative systems and can thrive within them. My educational background and my administrative experience is hands-on, I think I'm that leader that can help us bring our parish forward in the future. I know firsthand the challenges that our community faces, and I'm willing to put my expertise in motion to help solve these things with accountability and transparency. I appreciate your consideration for me as your parish president.
Mr. Landry, thank you. Next, Mr. Emil Pelletieri.
Hi, I'm Emil Pelletieri. I'm a lifelong resident of St. Bernard, class of 1980, graduate from Chalmette High School. I've had my own construction business since 1978. I'm a community activist, first and foremost. I've had 4 to 5 years of doing so, from pre-Katrina all the way through current days. Sometimes I'm in the forefront of different groups, sometimes I'm in the back. Campaign first, I'm sorry, Frank. Transparency and honesty will be a staple of my administration. The good old boy days are over. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pelletieri. Mr. Louis Pomez.
I first want to thank the chamber for hosting this forum tonight. Greatly appreciate it. I'm Louis Pomez, lifelong resident of St. Bernard Parish, born and raised in St. Bernard Village. For the past 40 years, I have worked in almost every department in parish government. For the past 7.5 years, I've been serving as Chief of Operations for Public Works Department. I have worked under 6 parish presidents. I have seen all of the good points and not so good points. I have learned what a leader should do and not do. I am the go-to guy when disaster hits St. Bernard Parish. The first to be seen when disaster strikes and the last one to leave. I have a great working relationship, council, St. Bernard Sheriff's Office, and the Southeast Flood Authority. There's no other candidate in this race that knows the ins and outs of parish government like I do for the past 40 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pomez. We'll get to our questions now. For question number one, prior to Hurricane Katrina, the population in St. Bernard Parish was at or above 60,000. Presently, the population is closer to 45,000. If elected, what will you do to encourage people to live and work in St. Bernard? And we'll get with Mr. Landry.
Oh, thank you. Well, first of all, one of the things that we have to recognize is what made St. Bernard great years ago was our way of life. My generations ago, my grandparents moved here to do trapping in Delacro Island, and it was the way of life and the natural resources we had. Obviously, if the port comes, it's going to make it an overwhelming challenge for all of us to bring people into St. Bernard. I think I'd rather have people come to St. Bernard and the big landowners develop it for residential areas as opposed to businesses like the port. Those types of investments aren't good. I'm not interested in those billion-dollar investments. I'm interested in the investors that come in and invest in their homes. And that's going to be what brings St. Bernard back to where you get the right kind of people populating St. Bernard. The amenities, of course, are something else that we have to do. The blight that we have, we have to correct that. I mean, we've got blight all throughout the parish, so we have to get stricter code enforcement and do those things that make our way of life like it used to be. I guess, you know, what I'm saying is we got to make St. Bernard great again. Just, you know, it was a great place to live, and it still is. But if we allow this port to come in, I think it's going to hamper us so badly that it's going to be very difficult to attract new people. What attracts new people is us. We have to clean up our act, move forward, make St. Bernard great again, and people will come back.
Mr. Landry, thank you. Mr. Pelletieri.
One more comment.
Yes, sir. So prior to Hurricane Katrina, the population in St. Bernard Parish was at or above 60,000. Presently, the population is closer to 45,000. If elected, what would you do to encourage people to live and work in St. Bernard Parish?
Okay. I had checked into the population just because I was curious. When we were kids growing up, we were closer to 52,000.
Well, I'm sorry, could we speak closer to the mic?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. When we were growing up, my age group, we had about 52,000. So we're about 10,000 less, I mean more than we have now, which, you know, when you're a kid, you think that there's not as many people as there is. But anyway, I am safety first, support our schools, our police, our firemen, and I'm okay with the population like it is. long as we take care of our own. So I'm not looking to encourage anybody. Yeah.
Mr. Pelletieri, thank you. Mr. Pomez.
Well, you know, after Katrina hit, St. Bernard Parish did a really good job on bringing back the residents to St. Bernard Parish. I think we're back up right now to about 45,000 population. The council put together a Ms. Gillis McCluskey and them a Solon St. Bernard Araby area. We started moving houses at 350 to 400,000, bringing our residents back to St. Bernard. That was going great until the insurance rates went through the roof. The homeowners insurance is stopping a lot of property sales throughout the state of Louisiana. I think together we need to get with the legislators and the a couple of the insurance companies to see what we can get to lower this insurance on the homeowners to help sell some of these homes that we have that's available in St. Bernard Parish. Thank you.
Mr. Pomez, thank you. Ms. Kelly.
Yes, so when, you know, one of the things I've heard recently is, you know, when someone is running for office, you should look at their record, not what they say. And one of the advantages I have is for the last 8 years, that has been our priority. When we came into government in 2015, we had scattered redevelopment. We had 1,000 lots that were out of commerce, and we didn't have the quality housing stock that we needed to bring back population in St. Bernard. And that was our mission. You know, we knew if we wanted to bring businesses, we had to foster an environment that was prevalent for residential growth. And we did that. We started the Sold on St. Bernard campaign. We created a housing stock that was viable in our market. We brought young families to St. Bernard. We were able to create a housing stock that was attractive to people living across our region, and we made St. Bernard a place that people wanted to be. We have become the fastest growing parish in our state, and Araby has become the second fastest growing suburb in our nation. And that is because of the efforts we've put in over the last 8 years. We're going to continue that effort. We're going to continue to make sure that St. Bernard is a place that our region wants to go. And our safety and our school system and all of the quality of life that we have brought to St. Bernard will draw people in to want to be a part of what we've created here in our parish. And insurance is definitely going to be an issue. And I think I'm uniquely qualified to be able to go to Washington, D.C. and work with our congressional delegation and use the relationships that I've already built to make sure that we can make the best possible situation for our residents.
Ms. Kelly, thank you. Question number two, and again, you have 90 seconds to respond. If the port project moves forward, how will you make sure the citizens of St. Bernard benefit from its development? What is your plan to mitigate the impacts on residents and make sure infrastructure improvements are made to lessen the burden? And we'll begin with Mr. Pelletieri.
Yeah, hi. The port cannot be allowed to come here. No matter what they say, they're not going to live up to it. It's not going to benefit us. It's going to be New Orleans first, and there is no second option. We have to fight them as long as we can.
Thank you. Mr. Pomez.
Well, I was the first one to go against the port of St. Bernard. From the day I heard of the port coming to St. Bernard Parish, I was the first one out front against it. And I will still fight against the port of St. Bernard coming here. The infrastructure that St. Bernard has is not going to tolerate with 1,500 trucks, 1,700 trucks per day running through our parish. The rails are not set up for the rail cars that are going to go through the parish, the traffic jams. If you go to the port of New Orleans up there and you look at the concrete structures up that way, they're about 12 inches thick, and you come down to St. Bernard Parish and look at our roadways, well, they're not interstate roadways. They for parish use. We have probably about 5.5 to 6 inches of concrete in here. It's going to destroy the infrastructure of St. Bernard. It's going to destroy the quality of life, not only in the area of Violet where this port, where they plan on trying to put this port, but throughout the whole parish. It's going to destroy the quality of life. And as the next parish president, I will stand strong against that port from coming to St. Bernard Parish. It'll be my fight, whether I'm in office or out of office. I will continue to fight against the port coming to St. Bernard Parish. Thank you.
Mr. Pomez, thank you. Ms. Kelly.
So it's easy to say you're against the port when you haven't actually been happy to make that decision. I'm the only candidate who has actually voted on the record against the port going back as far as 2021. and I stood with our district attorney in filing a lawsuit claiming that St. Bernard has sole jurisdiction over that area. But to answer your actual question on what if it does come here, while we have been fighting against that project, we have also been making sure that we're using all angles possible. I have made sure that the port did not realign St. Bernard Highway and kept that on the current track. I was a big part of making that happen to make sure that that highway stays open to our residents, to make sure that RPC funded the engineering and design of a roadway to make sure that the traffic does not go on our roads in St. Bernard if we are subjected to this port coming here. We have to make sure that we are using all avenues possible, both to fight the port and both to make sure that if this project is shut down our throats, that we are capable of reacting in the right way and making sure that our infrastructure is not harmed and our quality of life is not harmed in this parish. And I am the best representative to make sure that those things don't happen and our citizens are protected no matter what the outcome is. Thank you.
Ms. Kelly, thank you. Mr. Landry.
Would you repeat that question? I
want Absolutely, to yes. So if the port project moves forward, how will you make sure that citizens of St. Bernard benefit from its development? What is your plan to mitigate the impacts on our residents and make sure infrastructure improvements are made to lessen the burden?
Okay, so obviously it doesn't do any good to just say I'm gonna stop the port and all that. You know, you have to have the right administration to put together the right team of environmental scientists and other people that can litigate the issue. I can promise you this, and I hadn't made one promise yet in this campaign, but I'm going to make it now. We'll leave no stone unturned to try and stop the port, because in my heart of hearts, I know that destroys our way of life. But to answer your question, how would we mitigate it? It's a hypothetical, so I'm going to give you a hypothetical answer. You know, there's a lot of, they're talking about 2 million containers a year passing through St. Bernard Parish. Obviously, the things is infrastructure, our subsurface drainage, all of that gets destroyed. Without having a superhighway built from that port to the interstate, I can't see how in the world that port could actually be put in place. I mean, there's just no way to move that many trucks through St. Bernard Parish. I would look at taxing some kind of way in the hypothetical, because remember, I'm not going to leave a stone unturned to stop it, but I'd look at some form of tax. I know we can't do a tariff on some of those containers as they pass through St. Bernard, if in a hypothetical we can't stop it. But we would have to siphon off some monies, because we're going to desperately need monies that we just don't have in this parish to maintain the roads, the drainage, and it'll even affect our storm drainage, the pumping stations, because of the drainage that subsurface. So that would be what I'd do to mitigate it.
Mr. Landry, thank you. Question number three. Now that the parish is responsible for its own drainage, how will you prioritize budgetary funds to fully fund infrastructure to support drainage and mitigate street flooding? What criteria will you use to determine which projects get funded first? And we'll begin with Mr. Pomez.
Well, currently right now with the administration we have in the council, we have approximately about $11 million worth of drainage work that's about to go out for bid. So we got a good start on that for the next administration coming in. There's going to be a really good start on drainage. The money's already there. The projects are already designed. It's a great start for the next administration. When it comes down to the pump stations, we inherited 8 pump stations from the Southeast Flood Authority. And pump stations were in horrible condition. In the last 2 years, we received somewhere around $7 million to upgrade these pump stations. We put 4 new engines. Each one of the engines was about $400,000 apiece. I'm sorry, about $500,000 apiece. The gears to turn and pumps was about $400,000, and the rebuild of pumps was another $300,000. The money didn't go far. There's still a lot of money needed for the drainage in St. Bernard Parish. We're maintaining about 160 miles of drainage canals with equipment that's approximately 18 years old, bought right after Katrina. That equipment's anywhere from $300,000 to $400,000 for each piece of equipment. They about hit their lifespan today. So the drainage is going to be a very important role for the next administration coming in, and a lot of hard work and a lot of money to be spent. Thank you.
Mr. Pomez, thank you. Ms. Kelly.
So I think drainage is probably going to be the biggest challenge that faces the next administration. Not only do we have the system that we've taken over, but our subsurface drainage that did not get the funding that it needed after Katrina. And part of the reason why I did not get that funding is we didn't have the people in place to go to Baton Rouge and to go to DC and request that funding. We did not make the request that St. Tammany Parish or Orleans Parish did to get the funding that we needed for drainage in St. Bernard. And it's a huge challenge that we're facing today. We have fought for the last 8 years to try to get that funding, and because it has been left alone for so long, it's been a challenge. I believe that I'm the best person for that position because I have the relationships in place. I've had the meetings with Senator Kennedy and Senator Scalise in Washington, D.C. I have those relationships already to bring the dollars that we need to be able to fix those problems. That is not a problem that local dollars can fix. It's just much too big. We have to have somebody that has the relationships to be able to go to Baton Rouge and D.C. and be respected and be, you know, part of that infrastructure to be able to bring those dollars down here, because that's the only way we're going to address that issue. We also need to make sure that our drainage canals are an asset in St. Bernard. We have waterways all throughout St. Bernard that are just dealt with instead of made into an asset. And we need to keep water in those canals so that they're maintained at the right levels, and make a quality of life improvement in some of our neighborhoods by being able to have landscaping and walkways and bike paths across St. Bernard. So I hope to continue to do that in St. Bernard.
Ms. Kelly, thank you. Mr. Pelletieri.
Yeah, I don't have the access to the data that some of the people running for parish president have. I do know how to take bids, get the best for our money. Streets that have been flooded for years and years. Veronica is one of them. Parts of Judge President Funeshamet. But we can't do it alone. We need to have federal dollars, and we'll go after it.
Mr. Pelletieri, thank you. Mr. Landry.
Well, I was against, and I've been very vocal about important issues that face our parish for a long time. I was against that taking over the equipment and that millage that passed. I think the people thought that by passing that millage, it was going to solve their drainage problems in the residential areas. It didn't, and it won't. You know, there are some dollars available right now to attack drainage, but it's not enough. And if we have one catastrophic pump fail, we have to divert all the funds to that pump, because anybody knows in St. Bernard, if you have a rainstorm that's pretty heavy in about 2 hours, your street's going to flood because the capacities can't keep up. So there are dollars available. We've left, like, and this is an unbelievable number, but it's verifiable. Since Katrina, we've left $200 million on the table. And it's not because of us, but because of the state. The waivers of income tax. Right now, refineries aren't paying a lot. They're getting a lot of waivers for tax. In two more years, we'll have the ability as a parish government and a council to decide how much of that can be waived. And those dollars are significant. Last year, just picking on Valero alone was $5 million of tax monies that didn't come to the parish that could have because of the tax waivers. There are dollars out there that we have to get, and I'm not saying we're gonna waive them all or not waive them, but other businesses right now are struggling with taxes, and we're giving people out of making billions of dollars tax waivers. That's where the drainage money can come from.
Mr. Landry, thank you. We will now have your closing statements. You'll each have 1 minute, and we'll begin with Ms. Kelly.
Thank you. St. Bernard needs a parish president that is and always has been active in our community, not someone that only comes out during election times. Someone that has a plan of action and a record of financial integrity, not rhetoric or a history of disastrous initiatives. We need someone that when disaster strikes, we can be proud to have in front of a news camera or in meetings in Washington, D.C. We need someone who will continue to move St. Bernard forward and not set us back 20 years. We need someone who can bring our people together, work with our local and regional partners, and be a face that St. Bernard residents can be proud of. I am that leader for St. Bernard Parish, and I will be proud to represent you as St. Bernard's next parish president. Thank you.
Ms. Kelly, thank you. Mr. Landry.
Well, first I want to thank y'all for putting the forum on, and I think it's we have to give accolades to everybody who puts themselves out there to run for office. It's a tough thing to do. You're right that we have to get people who have education and people who can actually represent us in Washington and navigate through those government bureaucracies. You're absolutely right about that, Ms. Kelly. And this is an important election. This is a major crossroad for St. Bernard Parish. You know, I've spent years dedicated to studying and implementing, you know, transparent governance with efficiency. And really, that is what we need right now in St. Bernard Parish. We need a leader that can take the reins, pull teams together, make things happen. But more importantly, we need a team that can actually go to Washington and represent us in such a way that we're able to obtain funding. The finances are easy. I've managed $60, $80 million budgets, but everything else comes hard.
Mr. Landry.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Pelletieri.
Yeah, hi. Just a couple things. The Soul St. Bernard project, and everybody's happy with it, sold a bunch of houses. It was discriminatory against most of the local builders. It was a group of chosen builders that got pretty much all the work. So I am a little bit bitter about that, so as y'all can tell. But we'll work with everybody, secure safety, full funding for fire department, work with our police, and help our school board come up with a plan that we can get on board with for safety for our kids in school. It's really their project, and they're not supposed to be raising your kids either. So we've got to all get together and get on the same page with it.
Mr. Pelletieri, thank you. And Mr. Pomez.
I think Mr. Landry said it right. I think St. Bernard Parish needs a leader that can take the reins and lead the team. I'm that guy. For the past 40 years, I've been serving the residents of St. Bernard Parish, not in a part-time position, but in a full-time position. I work anywhere from 5 to 6 days, sometimes 7 days a week. When disaster strikes St. Bernard Parish, myself and my team, we're the first out there on scene. We're the last ones to leave. When it comes down to the administration and running budgets, I run millions of dollars in budgets. My budget in road department is in the millions between the sanitation, the roads, the road lighting. One time we had animal control, mosquito control, all of that fell under my department. I supervised hundreds of employees in St. Bernard Parish in my 40-year career. I have worked in every department in parish government. Thank you.
Mr. Pomez, thank you. And at this time, we'd like to thank all of our candidates running for St. Bernard Parish President. At this time, we will now hear for the candidates running for Council at Large East. So if you guys can come up to the chamber.
Anywhere?
All right, at this time, we're going to get going with Council at Large East with our candidates Wanda Alcon and Fred Everhart. Each of you will be giving a 60-second opening statement. I'll also give you a round of questioning. And can I get the audience to just remain quiet while the rest of the forum is going on? That'd be great. Thank you. I'll ask you a total of 3 questions apiece. You'll get 90 seconds to respond to each. If you need me to repeat a question, I'm happy to do so. I just can't interpret or elaborate on that individual question. So we're going to start off our forum with 3 opening statements. And again, you have 1 minute apiece. And we'll begin with Ms. Wanda Alcon.
Thank you. Thanks to the chamber for this event. I'm Wanda Alcon. I'm married to my husband, Clyde. We have 3 sons and 5 grandchildren. I'm born and raised and lived my whole life in St. Bernard Parish. I graduated from St. Bernard High School and am a legal secretary and a certified administrative assistant. I'm deeply involved in my community in organizations like the Autism Awareness Crew, Battered Women, Versus Lano Society, and the Business and Professional Women's Club. I have received a Legislator of the Year Award from the Alliance for Good Government twice. I've received the Lieutenant Governor Ambassador for Tourism Award, and I've been named Woman of the Year by St. Bernard Business and Professional Women's Club. When I decided to run for office, St. Bernard did not have the best reputation. After being elected, I worked with my fellow council members and the administration to try to make the best, we focused on making the best government that we could for our residents. Thank you.
Ms. Alcon, thank you. Mr. Fred Everhart.
Thank you all for coming out today. Great crowd. My name's Fred Everhart. I've been a lifelong resident of St. Bernard Parish. I was elected councilman in 2008 to 2012. Was re-elected back 4 years ago for this term as councilman of District E again. My history goes back to construction. I've been in construction for over 24 years, and after Katrina hit, I went 100% commercial fishing. I'm engaged to Ms. Vicki Morales. April 26th is our wedding, and I have four beautiful children. And I look to be your next councilman at large in District E. I mean, in East. I was waiting for him to pick that paper up.
I'll wait for you to give us all an invitation.
Well, come on.
All right, we're now going to have our first question of the evening, and for this question, you'll have 90 seconds to respond. Question number one, if elected, what is your plan to open fire stations 11 and 12? And we'll begin with Mr. Everhart.
That's a great question. I led the charge on getting fire station 11 back open. We are currently working on 12. We're going to have to pass some more legislation to try and get, force the parish president to go ahead and start the process and put the funding in place. Everybody knows that fire stations, the eastern part of the parish, the administration was trying to take fire protection out of District 2 and brought it in District 1 to enhance District 1's fire rating. I led the charge and we beat the administration. We've got our trucks and our manpower back. So as far as 11 and 12, 11 is open already. And the station's not built, but the truck is down there. And we're also working on rebuilding fire stations 12.
Mr. Everhart, thank you. Ms. Alcon.
Thank you. I am in much support of opening 11 and 12. As Fred said, 11 is already has a fire truck and manpower down there. But I'm also would like to bring back two. I would like to create the best possible fire department that we can have for all our residents, from Delacroix Island, Shell Beach, Hopedale, all the way to Araby. We do have challenges. We have manpower issues. We have to figure out how to defeat that problem and getting more people to come to work for the fire department. We have a new chief, and we have some great people. I respect the firemen because they go into fires and to save lives. It's a tough job. They need to be equipped. They need to have the right machinery and everything to do their job. And I will check into however we can, whatever we can do to help them succeed and to give fire protection to everyone in St. Bernard.
Ms. Alcon, thank you. Question number two. What do you hope to accomplish in this term that you were not able to accomplish in the last 4 to 8 years? And we'll begin with Ms. Alcon.
I think we have a lot of drainage issues that we need to try to get more funding for. My district especially, a lot of people are having issues. Back in the day, there were culverts that were put down that are now being destroyed. They're rotting. And so a lot of people have these sinkholes and all. So I think we need to definitely put some more money into being able to fix drainage issues. We also, we could always improve some of our roads. And we need to do more neighborhood parks for our kids. We need to try to bring in more business in whichever way that is, working with the chamber or with economic development or whoever it is. We need to try to do those things that help improve our parish. Thank you.
Ms. Alcon, thank you. Mr. Everhart.
Read the question.
Absolutely. What do you hope to accomplish in this term that you were not able to accomplish in the last 4 to 8 years?
It's a good question.
It's a tough question.
Drainage is one of them. She's right. All our subsurface drainage is falling apart throughout our parish, from Araby all the way to the eastern part of this parish. We need to find federal and state funding, mostly federal funding. We have to lobby our federal delegation to bring that funding to the state so it can come down to us, put projects together, make sure we get this drainage repaired. Also, coastal restoration. I want to finish on takeoff or where we left off on this term to make sure that we are putting more coastal restoration projects and fight for more funding and bring a lot more projects from the parish level to the CPRA and get that funding going, plus many more, and I just don't have the time to finish. Thank you.
Mr. Everhart, thank you. Question number three. Describe your level of involvement in the port permitting process thus far. Have you had conversations with any port officials, attended public meetings or community meetings? And if the port is permitted, how do you hope to convey the concerns of your constituents? And we'll begin with Mr. Everhart.
Well, the port is a long way from being permitted, so we don't even talk about that right now. I led this charge with the port. I found out the port was coming to this parish. I turned around and we brought a meeting with the port here, and we found out everything that was going on. So I called out all elected officials. I love working with the public to give them all the information they need to come help me fight for legislation. So we created a SOS group. I was the one that created the group. I went to Mr. Showalter. We made him the chairman. I was the vice chairman, and we took that community awareness group, and we got over 10,000 signatures against the port. So we had many meetings with the port. We passed legislation. I introduced legislation opposing the port. I brought it to the council. We voted on it. That is there. Now we're in the right track because our district attorney has taken over and found litigation that they're overstepping our boundaries with the port, with the jurisdiction process back in the day. So as far as the port, you're looking at him. I'm the man that's against it, always been against it. I am the one that let everybody know what's going on, and I will continue to fight against the port.
Mr. Everhart, thank you. Ms. Alcon.
Thank you. I am opposed to the port. I am opposed to Port Nova Project. I have said it many times. This is a project that is poorly planned and has never been sent before the people of St. Bernard to approve. They have no concern for our wildlife, our wetlands, or our citizens and the difficulties they'll face. However, I will fight until the first shovel goes in the ground. Once that happens, then I have to switch over and start fighting for what is good, what's the best interest of our people. What can we do to mitigate the damages that they're going to cause? Too many trucks on the street, our wetlands. What about the people that live in the nearby communities? These are the kind of things that we have to fight. We have to get in there and give everything that we've got to stop whatever they're going to do to harm our parish.
Ms. Alcon, thank you. It's now time for your closing statements. Each of you have 1 minute. We'll begin with Ms. Alcon.
Thank you. I'm running for council at large east, and let me tell you why. I'm not done yet. I was thinking about all the positive things that we have done in St. Bernard Parish over the last 8 years. We spent millions in civic projects like neighborhood parks and bike paths. We've done civic and community events like Wind Down Wednesday and Christmas in the Oaks. Christmas at the complex, I'm sorry. And all these things are free for our residents. We never had that in St. Bernard Parish before. We've done things that bring our communities together. I was chairman of the Tourist Commission, promoted film and film incentive, got the film incentive program going, and we brought in thousands in tax dollars from the films. I have served as chairman of the Cable Access Committee, served as president of BPW and BPW-LA, and on all boards in Economic Development, Executive Board, Regional Planning Commission, and I know what leadership is, and I'm asking you to please vote for Wanda Alcon for Council at Large East.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Alcon. Mr. Everhart.
Thank you. Thank you all again for coming out and showing your support and wanting to know what you feel, letting us introduce you and let us know how we feel and what our platform is. Like I said, I'm a lifelong resident of St. Bernard Parish. If you know me, you follow me. I'm a fighter, I'm a go-getter. I made many accomplishments in the eastern part of this parish. I want to bring that energy from Araby all the way down to the eastern part, Delacroix Island, White Klosky, Shell Beach, and Hopedale. I have the experience, the knowledge. Here is just some of the legislation that I passed as a councilman. Look up my record, follow the Facebook, go back, and before you make your vote, make sure you go back and do your due diligence and look at council meetings and see who's for and who is against the people, the politicians in this parish. I stood up for this parish, and I will continue to stand up for this parish. I want to continue to be your voice, and I would love to do it at the council at large seat. Fred Everhart, number 56, Councilman at Large East.
Thank you. Thank you. Now let's thank our candidates for the council at large East position. this time, we're now going to hear from candidates running for Council at Large West. At this time, we want to introduce our candidates for Council at Large West, Howard Luna and Gillis McCloskey. Each of you will provide a 60-second opening statement and then a 60-second closing statement after a round of questionings. Each question is going to be 90 seconds apiece to respond. We'll give you three, and if you'd like, I can repeat that question for you. I can't elaborate or interpret it, but I can certainly repeat it. But at this time, we are going to begin our forum with your opening statements. And again, you each have 1 minute. We'll begin with Mr. Howard Luna. Oh, and again, audience members, if y'all could just keep the noise level down a little bit. If y'all need to talk, just walk outside so our candidates aren't distracted. So thank you. Mr. Luna.
Thank you. I wanted to take time to say thank you to the chamber, and particularly to everybody else who showed up in taking an interest in the election. My name is Howard Luna. I'm a lifelong resident of St. Bernard. Charlotte and I have been married for over 42 years. We raised three children here and have actually, we have five grandchildren. I've been a council member for District C for 8 years, and prior to that I was a justice of the peace in Ward G for 3. Being an at-large council member takes time, takes effort, and an unwavering desire to do what's right for the people. It takes not being afraid to say no. It takes being responsive to you, it takes answering the phone when you call, it takes listening to you, seeing what you see, and in some cases, smelling what you smell. It takes providing answers to your questions and finding solutions to your concerns. These are the things that I've done as District C's council member and will continue to do as your Council at Large West council member. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Luna. Next, Mr. Gillis McCloskey, your opening statement, 60 seconds.
Thank you. First, I'd also like to thank the Chamber of Commerce for hosting this forum and to all those who helped make tonight possible. My name is Gillis McCloskey, and I'm running for Council at Large West. I'm a lifelong resident of St. Bernard, and as an Islanios, my family is among the founding members of this parish. I'm a graduate of Holy Cross High School and a graduate of the University of New Orleans, where I earned a bachelor's degree in political science with a concentration in pre-law. As area manager for quality labor management, I develop growth strategies that focus on finding careers for tradesmen and women. For the last eight years, I've served as councilman in District A, and despite 21 tropical events, two tornadoes, and COVID, we created an environment that turned St. Bernard into the fastest growing parish in Louisiana, and Araby, Louisiana, into the second fastest growing suburb in America. And most importantly, I'm husband to Leslie Coleman McCloskey and father to Riley and Gillis McCloskey. Thank you.
Thank you. Again, we're going to have our first question. You will have 90 seconds to respond to each one, so we'll get going with question one. What do you believe the biggest impacts would be for St. Bernard Parish if the Louisiana International Terminal Project moves forward, and what is your plan to mitigate those impacts? And we'll begin with Mr. McCloskey.
Thank you. The biggest impacts for this project would be the lack of infrastructure. So there are many impedances to the quality of life in St. Bernard regarding this project. I think one of the most detrimental things would certainly be rail. With the onboarding of the PBF biodiesel project, we've already seen a 2x increase in rail traffic, and I'm assuming that that will increase further as that project comes online. In addition to that, if we were to add the LIB project, we would be looking at a 4x increase in rail traffic in St. Bernard Parish. That would be absolute dreadlock for this parish. The deadliest chemicals known to man go on that Norfolk Southern spike, and unlike what happened in East Palestine, that rail spike goes through our neighborhoods within inches of the homes in District A and across our parish. So I believe that that would be one of the most difficult things to overcome. I do believe that's the most significant environmental objection that we lodged against the Corps of Engineers, and I'm very familiar with this permitting process, having taken on the IHNC lock project and taking that fight to DC. And I think I'm the only candidate in this race that can say I fought this particular permitting project, this particular permitting process. I have experience with it, and I think I'm the right person to fight this fight on behalf of St. Bernard. Thank you.
Mr. McCloskey, thank you. Mr. Luna.
Could you repeat the question?
Yes, sir.
One more time, please?
What do you believe the biggest impacts would be for St. Bernard Parish if the Louisiana International Terminal Project moves forward, and what is your plan to mitigate those impacts?
I think that when you look at the LIT project, some of the things that you need to look at is again, separating the port from the infrastructure, because they are actually two different projects. And the port will be the first one to tell you that they're not in the business of building roads. They will continue to move forward with the project regardless of what happens with the north-south corridor. I can't imagine what it would be like for us to have to deal with the truck traffic that's going to come down Judge Perez and then take the ride and go up Parish Road. I mean, I know I live in District C. I know how it is to cross the highway. I know how it is to look at Parish Road, which is an infinite turning lane. So I can't imagine what that would be. So it's not in addition to the traffic, it's the damage that's going to be caused on the roadways. It's the damage to the houses. It's the damage to businesses there. When we talk about rail, again, the same thing. The impact that we're starting to see on the expansion of PBF, which is very minute compared to what the port is going to do, is going to, again, hold things up for us. It's gonna separate the parish again when you have to wait for the train. And by the way, we have a law out there on the books that says you should only wait 5 minutes for a train. Well, that's not happening today. So I do believe, and again, working with the railroad and anybody who's tried to work with the railroad can understand that they really don't listen to us. So I'm gonna tell you that I'm opposed to the port. I don't think there's any trust there. There's no transparency there. And so I just can't see us surviving anything that the port brings us. Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Luna, thank you. Question number two, what are some recreational and or quality of life projects that you would like to see in St. Bernard? And we'll begin with Mr. Luna, and you have 90 seconds to respond.
Thank you. I mean, when I ran 8 years ago, part of my platform was quality of life. It's amazing because it's the buzzword today of everything we do. And again, part of the quality of life things is looking at from neighborhood parks to recreation facilities and how can we make all of that work as together, right, as one big piece of how we move forward. It involves the bike paths and things like that. What we need to continue to concentrate on and bringing those quality of life projects to St. Bernard are those things that are going to keep residents here. So not only keep the ones we have, but attract new ones here. So there needs to be, and again from a recreational perspective, a working relationship between the booster clubs and the recreation department. I think there's a lot of benefit that can be had by that. I think they both have a lot of resources and a lot of experience to make that happen. So again, I think it goes hand in hand, quality of life, recreation. It actually overflows into everything we do. Thank you.
Mr. Luna, thank you. Mr. McCluskey.
Thank you. I've spent a great deal of my last 8 years focused on recreation. Before I took office, I heard the word impossible a lot when people said we couldn't get our booster clubs back. Lo and behold, 8 years later, we have 4 thriving booster clubs in St. Bernard Parish. Those parks are so important because that's where parents meet parents and kids meet kids and lifelong bonds are formed. So it's not just about the actual recreational asset. It's about those people working together to build something and they form bonds. And that is the fabric of our community here in St. Bernard Parish. One of the things that I believe is lacking for St. Bernard Parish is something for our kids to do other than playing on video games, right? So yes, we have sports, and that's a super important thing, but we need to create other amenities. We had an event at the Acock Barn the other night. It was an outdoor movie night, and it was fabulous. I mean, it was so great to see our kids experiencing something different in St. Bernard and just playing, and we need a lot more opportunity for that. We just created a dog park, and we also have Vista and Patricia Park coming online in 2024. So I believe that recreation is one of the most important quality of life amenities that we can focus on in St. Bernard Parish. Thank you.
Mr. McCluskey, thank you. Question number three, how will you obtain funding for an industrial cleanup of waterways near and around Paris Road? And we can with Mr. McCluskey.
Thank you. First off, the best way to obtain any large-scale funding for a project is going to be through the grants department. So we would have to pull money back from within the general fund, classify that money as a match for a grant that would facilitate a large-scale project of that kind. I believe that working through that process is something that I've done quite a bit as a councilman. I'm very familiar with the grant process. I'm very familiar with the budget and how to allocate funds from one space to another. So I believe that would be the way to do it. Thank you.
Mr. McCloskey. Mr. Luna.
You know, cleaning up the waterways is important, and not just along Parish Road, but through all the canals and that move through the neighborhoods. From a funding perspective, the cheapest money that we could actually go after would be a full grant that we don't have to pay back. The second thing is we look at matching grants, so where we have to, for example, contribute 20% of the total project, and then the government or the state chips in the rest. And then the last one, of course, is actually two more. One is to utilize what we have in terms of Go Mesa money that we can use for cleanup in coastal projects to handle those. I think that's important for us. I think from a funding perspective, we have to continue to look at where we spend our money and are we spending it in the right place and maybe reallocating things somewhere else. It's focusing is what it's all about. It's understanding where we need to focus our attention. Parish Road's important, but we got a lot of other places in the parish that need help as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And now it's time for your closing statements. You'll each have 1 minute, and we'll begin with Mr. Luna.
Thank you. You know, I believe every year is critical for us. Promise to work with things that are important for our community, like look for the best way to deal with coastal erosion that doesn't impact our fishermen or our environment. Gain our share of infrastructure money. Provide fire protection and emergency response for everyone in St. Bernard. Support a compliance department that's proactive and ensures that compliance applies to everyone. Provide the resources to improve the handling of water. Finding ways to assist our local fishermen and to protect their way of life. Look for quality of life projects that actually protect our way of life. Look to spend your money as we spend ours. Fight the development of the port, no exceptions, no compromising. And find a balance between economic development and quality of life. There are common needs across all districts. There's also a quality to each one as well. And this uniqueness, it's this uniqueness that makes us different, but makes us special. From A to E, from east to west, from up the road to down the road, I promise to invest the time, the effort, and the work it takes to make our community prosper by holding to the right things that make each of us unique and special.
Mr. Luna, thank you.
I humbly ask for your support in the election.
Thank you. Mr. McCloskey.
Thank you. The most important thing an elected official can do is deliver on the promises they make to the people who elect them. I make it a point to publish my goals with the intent of holding myself accountable. 8 years ago, I promised to repair the water lines, assist with the creation of neighborhood associations, leverage grant funding, create a strategic marketing plan, and to extend Old Araby success. We've accomplished those goals, and I have a new set of goals for St. Bernard. We will grow our commercial sector by focusing on economic development. We will improve code enforcement. We will increase fire protection. We will reduce insurance rates. And we will fight to stop the Port of New Orleans from executing a disastrous plan for an unwanted project. This requires an in-depth understanding of governmental budgeting, complex federal permitting procedures, and the ability to engage at the local, state, and federal level. That's why I feel I'm the best candidate for this position. My name is Gillis McCloskey, and I'm asking for your vote as Council at Large West. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you to our candidates now running for Council at Large West. At this time, we will now hear from our candidates running for Council District D. They include Andrew Hunt, Ryan Randall, Doris Stogner, and Cyrus Sylvester. And you guys can have a seat anywhere where there's not a white paper on it. Each of you will be allowed an opening statement, 60 seconds apiece, followed by a 60-second closing statement after we've read all three questions. Each question will have 90 seconds to respond. If you need me to repeat a question, I can definitely do that. However, I cannot elaborate or interpret a question. And again, I'm going to ask the audience, as all of you are kind of getting settled once again, just keep the noise level down. It's a little distracting for our candidates when they hear you talk. That includes whispers. Thank you. At this time, we're going to begin with your opening statements. You've got 60 seconds to respond, and we'll begin with Mr. Andrew Hunt.
First, I'd like to thank my lovely bride and campaign manager. She's definitely been whipping me into shape, and I'm loving it because every time I run for election, I lose a few pounds, so there's a golden opportunity for that. The reason why I'm running today, and the main reason why, is because I feel that we're being attacked right now when it comes to the port. And a lot of people think that it's a done deal. I've been knocking on doors. And some people say, well, you know, Mr. Hunt, I'd love for it not to come, but I think it's a done deal. And I've been encouraging people to say that nothing's a done deal till it's done. We have a lot of stuff coming down the pike. With SOS, I'm a major plaintiff. We've been suing them for a couple years now. We have some pretty damaging reports that will be coming out very soon. I've seen the preliminary, and I think it's going to help our case great. And at the same time, we got the DA that just stood up, and he filed his suit where it's against the Louisiana Constitution for a port authority to operate outside of their jurisdiction. And I'm here to say, 10 seconds, I'm here to say that I'm not about that, and at the same time, I want to be a representative for our district that I love, and I owe a debt of gratitude to all of our people that have made me successful. Mm-hmm. And I want to bring my talents
to the council.
Thank you.
Mr. Ryan Randall.
Thank you for hosting this event today. My name is Ryan Randall, and I'm running for Council District D. I've been married to my wife for 15 years. I'm a lifelong resident of not only St. Bernard, but of District D. My service to this community started in my teenage years working at the Good Samaritan Center in Lower St. Bernard, which was founded by my Uncle Walter with the help of Mr. Lynn Dean. I'm the current chair of the St. Bernard Parish Planning Commission, and I'm also a member of the St. Bernard Charter Committee. I have a bachelor's degree in urban and public affairs with an emphasis on land use and disaster management, two things that could not be more important to St. Bernard Parish. I am the most qualified, experienced, and educated person for the honor of representing District D. I look forward to using my skill set in helping them grow.
Mr. Randall, thank you. Mr. Cyrus Sylvester.
My name is Cyrus Sylvester. I'm married to Leslie Green Sylvester. We've been married 13 years. I also have my daughter, Libra Green. She's pregnant, about to have a baby in October. I'm so happy about that. But I am the voice. I want to be the voice for the people of District D. I want to be the person to help you get things done. We've been battling a lot of things. We've been going through a lot of things. And all we're doing is people say they think they're going to do things and nothing can happen. But I want to be the person that going to your neighborhood, your community, to get things done. Listen to what you want to get done. Listen with your ideas, things that you can do for yourself and for your district. And I'm the guy to make the district better. I'm the guy willing to listen to you. I'm the guy to go in the neighborhood and work with you. Not behind the desk, but go in the community to get things done.
Thank you, Mr. Sylvester. Well, now go through our first question, and again, you've got 90 seconds to respond. Question number one, if the port project is permitted, how do you plan to establish a clear line of communication and mitigation efforts to address concerns in your community promptly? And we'll begin with Mr. Randall.
So the challenges that it's going to face to be permitted are numerous, but if it were to get through, we have to follow up with all of the correct infrastructure to support it, to save St. Bernard Parish from being 100% ruined. The challenges that it's going to face are the size of ships that they've promised, the fact that they've promised it's going to be automated, cutting jobs. The Tulane University just came out with a great study talking about the environmental impact that it's going to have. But getting back to point on if it does happen, we have to work with local, state, and federal leaders to make sure we get every dollar possible to support the infrastructure that's needed to make sure that it does not destroy our way of life. Thank you.
Mr. Randall, thank you. Mr. Sylvester.
Well, I think it would need to happen. I believe that the port would be a bad thing for our community. First of all, congested traffic and the environment, and then I broke the school. I think we can come together and we file a lawsuit with the DA. I believe we don't give up. I believe as a community, we can come together and we can stop this. Never give up. People say it might be a hard battle to climb, or uphill climb battle. But we can do it. We just come together as a people of the whole District D and let them know what needs to be done and what have to be done in our community. We don't want it here. Just don't want it. And we're going to stand on that.
Mr. Sylvester, thank you. Mr. Hunt.
I'm so glad you asked. Listen, right now is not the time for us to say if. Now, if, and we're pushed to it, of course, we need certain infrastructure. But they're promising us a bunch of nonsense. They're saying they're going to put the Florida corridor. They've been saying that for 30 years. We got wetland allocations. We got wetland. They have to go and buy other wetlands. Sometimes it's 10 to 1 in the same parish. There's land acquisitions, environmental studies. It's never going to happen. If we get this port, expect it. It's coming right down Judge Perez. It's coming right down St. Bernard Highway. After 2 years, one street will always be closed because of the damage that they're going to put on there. We don't have the time nor the inclination to talk about a done deal. What we need to do as a community is come together and know that things are starting to snowball for us, okay, guys? So it's time to encourage everybody, let us know that this fight isn't over. We have just begun to fight. And if the support so happens to come, let me tell you something. We got a study out right now. It's going to be obsolete by the time they're done. I'm an unapologetic capitalist. I'm all for people to pick themselves up by the bootstraps and go make money and create jobs. But at the same time, how are you going to build something in an area by the time it's done building, it's obsolete? Everything's going to mega containers. They're shipping cities over here. Logistically, it makes sense business-wise. Guess how much this port's going to get? Zero. Zero. And on the same time, it's maritime law. Guess how much taxes we're going to get? Zero. Guess how many jobs we're going to get? Very, very few. Okay? So when you look at all that stuff, you know who's getting the shaft? We're getting the shaft. So we need a voice on the council to be able to fight this thing, and I'm your
boss. 90 seconds. Question number two. District D has seen tremendous growth over the last 5 years. What is your plan to continue that growth and improve commercial development in your area? And we'll begin with Mr. Sylvester.
Well, the thing is, we need to listen to our people in our district. Ask them what needs to be done. Well, how do they feel about things? We represent them. We represent the people in District D. And our job is representing them, is getting what they need, and to get things that's done, that they want to get done, what they want to get done. So, this hand can't hide behind this desk. It's time for us to get up in the community and see what they need and what they want. And we need to do a lot of things in our district. And the district can get better if we all come together and ask, what they want. It's about the voice of the people. Not about us, it's about the voice of the people of District D, what needs to be done for them.
Mr. Sylvester, thank you. Mr. Hunt.
Well, I'm so glad y'all are asking wonderful questions. Let me tell you something when it comes to business, guys. We want these big box stores here and there. Of course, we don't want to impede on our mom and pops, but we have to have the demographics. Let me tell you what I've been involved with ever since I've blessed this place, and I love it. I bleed St. Bernard. My children are born and raised here. I can live wherever I want to live here. We have to have the demographics. We have to have a steady supply of new productive citizens coming in, which they are coming in. We have good people coming in. We're doing loans for them. We're getting them into houses. But without the demographics, we're not going to get the things that we want, okay? So that's how it is. Now, another thing is we still have a lot of blighted commercial properties that has been like that for 20-something years. I don't get that. I don't understand why we still have properties that haven't been touched. I'm not going to name them. You drive around. Y'all know what's up. We need to be able to go and make sense to them and say, listen, now it's time to get this rebuilt. At least put a face on the building. If you want to figure out how to do your taxes, we can show you how to do cost segregations and things like that to where you can deduct it from your taxes. But it's time to clean this place up. It's been 20 years since Katrina, and we can do it.
Mr. Hunt, thank you. Mr. Randall.
So if you follow commercial real estate, which I'm sure some people do, there's only about 13 commercial properties for sale in St. Bernard on the MLS. I'm sure there's more off, but to continue economic growth, you need more opportunity. Whenever I think of economic growth, I think of the fact that there's in District D, there's maybe 3 unoccupied buildings. And then that immediately leads me to thinking of something like the St. James Business Park. Beautiful, landscaped C1 commercial corridor with functional C2 properties behind it that can produce revenue, jobs, and support the community in numerous other ways. You can't just rely on recycling the same buildings that we have over and over again because we have an influx of people. We need an influx of commercial corridor to support the commercial growth. And that's it for me. Thank you.
Mr. Randall, thank you. Question number 3, in your opinion, what is the biggest issue facing your district and how have you prepared yourself to address that issue? And we'll begin with Mr. Hunt.
Well, I think by now it's probably no secret what I'm about to say, but let me tell you something. We live on a city basically shining on the hill. We have so much potential. We have so much potential. And with the right leadership in there, let me tell you something. When I need to be a jerk and I need to be as loud as the people want me to be, I'm your guy. When I need to be quiet and listen and learn something, I'm your guy. That's how I've been so successful throughout these years. Our biggest problem right now is this port they're trying to shove down our throat. A lot of people Very few people. Right now, we're at 73%. I think by the time I'm done knocking on doors and everybody else, we're going to be at 80% against it. 16% are for it. This is an SOS poll. 11% are clueless, which we're educating that as we go. But, guys, this is going to totally disrupt the whole landscape of everything that we have. And I know a lot are thinking that economically it's going to be great. I don't think so. You don't trade a jewel for a lump of coal and expect good things to happen in your community. Thank you.
Mr. Hunt, thank you. Mr. Sylvester.
My thing is, this is the poorest man dressed in our district. And we just put a school down there in Willie Smith for the kids to be educated. You know, up over the school, the kids just got comfortable learning the teachers learning them. I think that'll be probable if we move that school. And when we move the school, where are we going to put it? It's a question I have to ask. And number two, the traffic going to be so bad, the infrastructure, as all the heavy trucks coming through here, buildings going to be coming down. And people done put support, worked so hard for whatever they got, for their house, their cars, their homes. They invest a lot of money and time in that. Who wants their home to be towed down by heavy traffic, heavy equipment coming through here? We don't need that in here. We want them to go, and we want to come as in our district, things that we need to be done. And that thing we need to be done in our district, we need a youth center. We need a youth center for these children. We have nothing for these kids here. And I want to fight, I want a recreation development for these children in the neighborhoods. That's things that we need to be done and for our kids. We need to do more things for the children. The children is our future. And we got to start them, the Bible says, start them when they're young, when they're old, they're not depart.
Mr. Sylvester, thank you. Mr. Randall.
Well, I feel like I'm grabbing at low-hanging fruit here, but obviously the biggest problem facing all of St. Bernard Parish is the port. The people don't want it. It has major jurisdictional issues. The damage that it's going to cause is multifaceted. We don't have the infrastructure for it currently. The roads are not built to handle that type of traffic. We have one rail system. We are not only that, we're on the east side of the river. You have the Port of Mobile that would basically crush its availability. All ports being built in America are going deep water. This one's 51 miles, I believe, inland. It makes zero economic sense. At the end of the day, the destruction that it's going to cause will also be complicated by the fact that it is going to be a colossal waste of taxpayer dollars. And if we're going to address it, you know, as the biggest problem, that is 100% it, over and over and over again. Thank you.
Mr. Randall, thank you. We'll now begin with our closing statements. Each of you have 1 minute, and we'll begin with Mr. Hunt.
You know, I apologize if I come across angry, and that's really because I am. I've moved here in 07, the rebuilding days, 07, where houses were still in the middle of the street, you know what I'm saying, and we were putting them together, and I just fell in love with the tenacity of our people coming back, wanting to be back home. Great people, of course, 20 minutes down the road and go fishing, that's great too as well, I love that. But we're fighters, St. Bernard. Right now, we need the right people to rally behind to let them know not just what we don't want them to do, but at the same time, put the plans correctly together to let them know that not only is this a mistake for our parish, let me tell you something, they don't care about us. We're 25,000 voters. But I tell you what, 25,000 people coming together that can join together and rally behind leaders in our community, we can make some things happen. So if you want to come and talk to me, you come talk to me. I want to shake your hand. I'm in this to win it, and I promise you I'm not going to be a good councilman. I will be a great councilman. Thank you.
Mr. Randall.
Once again, thank you for your time tonight. My experience in working for multiple Fortune 500 companies has prepared me for one of the most challenging tasks a councilman can have, the budget. I've been involved in multi-million dollar budgets and been held accountable for every penny. From being the founding member of the St. Bernard Cooking Connection to being an avid leader in the community, hard work and dedication is what I promise the people of St. Bernard Parish. I'm not a politician. I haven't made a single promise to a single person anywhere along the way and on this journey. But what you will get is me working 100% for you. That's the difference between a leader and a politician. Lastly, this is an awkward thing for me. I'm not a boastful guy, but I have to sit up here and tell y'all why I'm the best candidate for a job and tell you all the things that I've done and accomplished. That's not what I'm about. I'm about hard work, dedication, and results. And to that end, I just humbly request y'all support Councilman District D, number 73. Thank you.
Mr. Randall, Mr. Sylvester.
My name is Charles Sylvester. I'm your voice, the voice for the people. Not a voice for myself, not a voice for my family, but a voice for District D. What is a voice? A voice is something that needs to be heard. What is a voice? A voice is something that's coming from you and from the District D, the things that need to be done. And it's not just listen to you, but just get work at it and get the job complete and get the job complete. And work hard by doing it, by getting the job complete. I'm a little nervous, but I know one thing. I'm an underdog. I feel like I'm David fighting Goliath. But you know, you're looking at me, who I am. I'm a man that work hard. I never take no for an answer. I never give up. I work hard, and I'm gonna work hard for you. It's not about me, it's about District D. I will make District D look better. I will make you happy. I will make you proud. I will make you smile. I'll make you feel good about yourself. I will make you feel good about District D. District D, we're wonderful people. We need to come together, District D. We are beautiful people in Seminole Parish, and I love this parish, and I work hard for you. I guarantee you, if I don't work hard, do not elect me.
Mr. Sylvester, thank you. We'd like to, at this time, and thank our candidates for Council District D and their time. At this time, we're now asking the candidates running for Council District E to come forward. Our candidates, ladies and gentlemen, for Council District E, Jimmy Corley, Amanda Serenay-Modez, and Travis Thurman. As you're getting your seats, each of you, in just a few moments, will provide a 60-second opening statement to the audience. After a round of questions, you'll also give us a one-minute closing statement. I'm going to ask you three questions. Each of you will have 90 seconds to respond, and you can pay attention to Fred and Eugene over here. They'll be giving you the time cards. If necessary, you can ask for a question to be repeated. However, I cannot elaborate or interpret that question for you. So this time, we're going to begin our forum with your opening statements. And again, you've got 60 seconds. We'll begin with Mr. Jimmy Corley.
Good evening, everyone.
Oh, 1 second. Can you speak closer to the mic?
Oh,
thank you. Sorry.
You're
very sensitive.
Good evening, everyone. Oh, thank y'all for coming out. My name is Jimmy Corley, and I'm hoping to run. I'm hoping to run for your councilman for District 8. With that being said, let me tell you a little bit about myself. I was born and raised in the eastern part of St. Bernard Parish. I graduated from St. Bernard High School in 1997. When getting out of school, I knew my career focus was going to be the outdoors. I started guiding duck hunts and picked up a trade while in the fitting. Everyone who knows me knows duck hunting is my way of life for me. I live and breathe it. In 2008, I hung up my welding shield and started my business. All I can say is I'm very blessed to have a successful business and able to thrive on a profession I have so much passion for. This business allows me to work with different organizations, New Orleans Tourism, St. Bernard Tourism, Ducks Unlimited, Knights of Nemesis, and a Reels program where we do restoration projects and teach our youth about the outdoors. I'm very involved in my community. I'm heavily involved in my church.
Mr. Corley, thank you. 60 seconds. I'm sorry.
That is it?
That's it. Sorry. I know it goes by really quick. And I hate being the cutoff person. I'm so sorry. Miss Amanda Mones.
Good afternoon. My name is Amanda Serenay-Mones, and I'm running for District E. I'm a Christian. I'm a wife. I'm a mother. I'm married to Jason Mones for 18 years now. We have a beautiful daughter. She's 22. And a handsome son. He's 16. My roots in St. Bernard Parish are deep, 9 generations deep, born and raised in the lower end of St. Bernard Parish. I have a large family. We work hard together. I'm on that crab boat every day with my husband. So is my son. I homeschool my son. My lifestyle gives me a very flexible schedule to be on call 24 hours a day. You need me, I'm gonna answer that phone. If you saw the fight we put up in District E, I don't know how many times I sat in his chambers fighting for our district and District E for this fire department. There's still a lot of work to do in District E, all kinds of issues to fix. And if you elect me, you don't get me, you get me and you get us all.
Ms. Funes, thank you. Mr. Travis Thurman.
Hey, I'm Travis Thurman. I'm running for council in District E. I've been a commercial fisherman for 16 years in this parish, since I was 14. I have four beautiful kids that I want to raise and keep this parish great. My education is I graduated from Chandler High School. I both attended Texas A&M University and Nunez. And I just want to keep this parish great and make District D a better place to live. Thank you.
Mr. Thurman, thank you. Again, I'm going to go through each question. You'll have 90 seconds to respond to each question. I'll begin with question one. St. Bernard Parish, of course, has a rich cultural heritage. How will you promote policies and allocate resources to encourage tourism and growth in District E? And we'll begin with Ms. Moniz.
District E is very unique down the road. We have a unique culture down there with the Slanos. It's a way of life down there. The commercial fishing industry is hurting. I will do everything that I can to help everyone with their culture, their heritage, whatever we need, get grants, get involved with the community, do what we can do just to keep our culture going, because I'm telling you, there's two things that's gonna hurt this culture and our heritage is the port and is big governments. So we need to stop that and they need to go.
Ms. Moniz, thank you. Mr. Thurman.
Our heritage has gone back many, many, many years in this parish. For instance, fishermen, which I know is a struggling industry. I'd love to make it a lot better than what it is. I'm a fisherman myself, and it's struggling. Some other activities we can do is maybe a little marketing to help out the Slanios, maybe make it a little larger, well-known. We can go, for instance, maybe state, get it better known throughout Louisiana, and I feel like there's a lot that we can do to better and be better known in District E. Thank you.
Mr. Thurman, thank you. Mr. Corley.
I'm glad you said tourism. So my whole business is revolving around tourism. I want to put tourism in front of our commercial fishermen. I have a platform set up right now that I'm working on to get tourism from New Orleans, which is a $1 billion industry that we can get down to St. Bernard Parish. So we're going to blow up our seafood markets. We're going to have our seafood markets like a festival, in other words. People's going to come down. I'm working with Ms. Barber to come down with the buses, with the tours, to bring the people down here to Lower St. Bernard Parish so we can tap into some of that money that New Orleans is having. So like I said, my business is all tourism. I know what I can do with my business, and I know exactly what I can do with the parish and make them a better place and then more tax revenue coming to our parish. Thank you.
Mr. Corley, thank you. Question number two. Coastal wetlands are vital for our ecosystem and our economy. How will you work to protect and restore these wetlands while balancing the needs of industries and residents that depend on them? And we'll begin with Mr. Thurman.
Yes, thank you. So we can definitely look into the funding and what's going on right now in the coastal restoration, maybe asking what their future plans are, make sure that they have a long-term goal. And then if maybe there's always room for improvement, maybe we can start different idea in a different situation to do a different kind of restoration or somewhere else to better ourselves. Thank you.
Mr. Thurman, thank you. Mr. Corley.
So I work with a foundation called the Reels Program. We do restoration and coastal marshland restoration projects. We go out there, we plant grass, we put wax myrtles, we put pine field grass in. So we just did a project, I guess, about a month or two ago where we was in Mosquito Bay, and it's all blocked in by concrete barriers. So when the tidal surge comes in, it'll hit the concrete barriers. So we went behind there, we planted a bunch of pine field grass. We planted 1,800 bulbs just to build up our marshland. Right now I'm working with them to try and get some wax myrtles. So we go plant some wax myrtles down. And we got, 500, I think, we requested for us. So I'm just waiting on funds, hoping that they give us funds to go do that project. Thank you.
Mr. Corley, thank you. Ms. Moniz.
Can you repeat the question,
please? Absolutely. Coastal wetlands are vital for our ecosystem and our economy. How will you work to protect and restore these wetlands while balancing the needs of industries and residents that depend on them?
Well, there's a lot of... There's a lot of projects going on with our wetlands. There's good ones, there's bad ones. I will fight with the ones who are not doing right. The ones that are doing right, I will work with, and we can do what we need to do. The ones that are demolishing our land, and, you know, oil industries and the Corps engineers, they taking away land that we'll never get back. So we really need to work with them, work with the companies who are really going to go out there and do that can restore our wetlands.
Ms. Menez, thank you. Question number three. What are the main concerns of the commercial fishing industry in St. Bernard Parish, and how will you address those issues if you are elected? Mr. Corley.
So imported shrimp is our number one goal, but right now we can't, we have to keep fighting that. I will fight that to the end. But right now our fishermen are starving. I have a fella right now who got 10 boxes of shrimp on that boat they cannot get rid of. That's why I want to bring the tourism down to St. Bernard Parish, promote it. Get our tourists to come in, buy our seafood from our product. I want to build a platform so we can just put it like on the internet. Facebook only goes so far. The internet is where it needs to be. So two of my friends, which they own their business, and they're going to take it and build a site. So when the fisherman comes in, they can put it on a website, say I got 400 pounds I need to get rid of, and we just market it. We have to market and then pull the tourism in St. Bernard Parish, and I got the capabilities and availabilities to do it. Thank you.
Mr. Corley, thank you. Ms. Menez.
The commercial fishing industry down there, they're tough people. We've had some bad times. We will get through this, but St. Bernard Parish is a knit community. The commercial fishermen are hurting right now, trying to sell their seafood. We need to come together as a community and get our local restaurants should be willing to sell local seafood. I mean, the big government is what's really, they started this, they hurt this. We need to fight and we need to get them to fix this. Because we're tough down there. But we work together and we stick together as a family, very family-oriented people down there. And when you get behind them, they'll work together. Thank you.
Ms. Munoz, thank you. Mr. Thurman.
Could you repeat it, please?
Absolutely. What are the main concerns of the commercial fishing industry in St. Bernard Parish, and how will you address those issues if you were elected?
Like I said before, I'm a commercial fisherman myself for the last 16 years. That's all I've known, besides my new company in college. What I would like to see is a lot more marketing and maybe a fresh produce, fresh seafood place opened up in Lower St. Bernard that is advertised very well, you know, maybe over the internet, maybe over some hotels or anything like that in New Orleans to get the people down here to help the dwindling fishermen that we have right now. You know, we can market it to get more profits of it. We can definitely look into federal grants, federal funds to help the people that are starving, like myself. Thank you.
Mr. Thurman, thank you. At this time, we'll now have your closing statements. Each of you will have 1 minute, and we'll begin with Ms. Monez.
This is my promise to District E. Elect me, and my only goal is to serve you. I don't work for the parish president. I work for my community, and I work for my people. If you elect me, you get a team behind me that will fight to the nail for you. Thank you very much.
Ms. Munoz, thank you. And Mr. Thurman.
Yes, thank you. Like I said, my name is Travis Thurman. The reason I'm running is to help the Lower St. Bernard end to get noticed. You know, we're forgotten people down there, and we can go on and on and on about that. But four things on my agenda, definitely doubt if I get elected, is the safety, fire department, lights, whatever it may be, EMT, and definitely to fight against the port. I have a different plan on fighting it, and I'm going to hopefully allow y'all to notice that. Also, child activities. We have no child activities, and I'd like to do that. I got 4 children, and every time I have to go outside the parish to do something with them. And then foremost, the fishermen. I'd like to help them out as much as I can. Thank you.
All right, thank you to our candidates here for Council District E. I'm sorry, Mr. Corley. I totally skipped you. I'm so bad. I had you already marked down. So, Mr. Corley, sorry, your closing statement.
I hope y'all Hope y'all share my vision and passion, my dedication to keeping our culture and heritage secure. Please give me an opportunity to serve and to serve you and our community, keeping our part in saving our parish strong. One thing about me is when I have passion for something, I never give up. Thank you again for coming out, and I hope everyone can have a good evening, and God bless.
Thank you, Mr. Crowley. And again, I apologize. Our candidates here for Council District E. And at this time, thank you to all of our candidates who came out tonight. Best of luck. We'll turn it now back to David Clement, Sr. for closing remarks.
Thank you to all my candidates for making it here tonight. Before we go, I would like to give a special thank you tonight.